Thanks for tuning in, everybody. This is Chef Mario from Newburgh Deli in Nazareth on Newburgh Road. I want to welcome you to this week's episode. I'm so glad you're here. We've got a lot to talk about. Another real ethnic dish for you today. A heartwarming dish, a super traditional one that anybody of any persuasion can make as long as you follow the steps. And this is Spanish style chicken enchiladas with green verde sauce. Be right back to show you how to make it. Stay tuned.
Enter to win 2 free tickets to the amazing Harlem Globetrotters at the PPL Center. The ultimate in basketball performance will entertain you and your family with unforgettable memories. You can win these 2 free tickets at the PPL Center. Go to 2freetticketslv.com.
We all know what a motion detector does. It triggers an alarm when motion is detected. However, what it doesn't do is give you information as to what caused the alarm. Introducing the patented Alarm.com image sensor. It's essentially a motion detector with an onboard camera that snaps a photo of what actually created the motion and sends it straight to your phone. You can use this to catch a burglar red-handed, receive visual verification that your child is home from school on time, check in on contractors, or even peek in on your puppy to make sure it isn't getting into trouble. Even if there is not a motion alert, you can request a live peek-in capture at any time to see what's happening back at the house. Perhaps the best part is it's completely wireless and battery powered, so you can put it wherever you want and use it however you want. The Alarm.com image sensor, just another way that Alarm.com keeps you at the cutting edge of interactive security technology.
We're back in the kitchen here with Chef Mario. Thanks for tuning in again. Chicken enchiladas in verde sauce. That's our episode this week. You know, have you ever really desired to make good Spanish food, especially Mexican food? You know, maybe you weren't born in Mexico. You know, maybe you're just kind of intimidated by, you know, the type of food that they make because it's so foreign to you. Well, you know, it can become very, you know, first nature to you or first hand to you if you just follow some basic steps. You know, this meal is a hearty meal. I've never met a kid that doesn't like this meal, really. When you mix chicken and cheese and various sauces, everyone is going to love this deal. You just got to pay attention. You know, before we get started, I did want to show you, you know, last week's episode, Foods That Heal. And I just wanted to show you those apricot seeds I talked about. Here we got the fresh apricots that we bought down at the market. And we've been eating the apricots and taking the seeds out. Inside there is a kernel, and that seeds for life. We talked about the B17. I just wanted to show you that, just to sort of summarize our talk last week. All foods can heal, and this food is going to heal your hunger. So here we go. We've got a lot of ingredients to consolidate here to make it just the right dish. We've got some beautiful chicken breast. It's actually a leg quarters, like, and I really like this for this dish. You know, a lot of people use breast per se, and I just don't think the breast has the flavor. A chicken quarter simmered the right way is going to make the dish happen. I've got paprika. I've got ground cumin. I got some real standard corn tortillas. Real cheap, a couple dollars. I mean, this meal is not expensive, but very hearty. I got some 4 blended cheese, Mexican style. Some fresh cilantro. You know, I got some rice here for a side dish. A little seasoning here, Spanish style. And I know this is going to really maybe upset the authentic Mexican folks, but it's the best I can do because of time constraints. I've got some green enchilada sauce, some verde sauce in a can. And we'll go over that in a minute, but this is the main ingredient here. I got some chipotle peppers to top it off. You can use green chilies. A side dish of some Mexican refried beans to really make the dish complete and authentic. Let's see how this thing works. Okay, the first thing we want to do is you want to get your meat going. It's the real basis of the meal. It takes the longest. Now, you can do a rush job on this. You can go out and buy yourself a rotisserie chicken at the supermarket or the big box club, bring it home, and you can kind of like shred it up and work it in that. And that's great, but I don't think you're going to get that really hearty, authentic, wow, I'm in Tijuana enchiladas. And this is how you're going to get that flavor. You're going to get the couple breasts like this, and you're gonna get a pot. Remember, you know, in Europe, America has fast food. In Europe, they have what's called slow food. And slow food is always better. If you have the time, do it right. slow food. Okay, we're gonna get a pot like this. We're gonna put a little water in the bottom. We're gonna get both of those chicken legs and we're gonna put them in here. This will make about 10 or 12 enchiladas real fast. So we got that chicken in there. Let me wash my hands real quick to get that residual gallinaceous germs off of me. I like that word, gallinaceous. That means bird-like. Okay, so the first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna salt and pepper that chicken generously, okay? Don't be afraid. Black pepper. We're gonna put some ground cumin in there. Real important ingredient in the Mexican cooking. Some paprika, a little on the spicy side. And what I like to do is I like to put a little bit of, I know it's over the top, a little bit of taco seasoning. Like so. And then you can put the lid on it. And then you're going to put it on the stove. And you're going to simmer that little guy as long as you can. This is not a meal you're going to make in a half hour, folks. It's going to be a long one. But if you do it right and you have the time, it's marvelous. So we're going to simmer that, you know, for quite some time. In the meantime, I've taken the liberty to sort of speed up the process. And, you know, I've got some chicken already cooking. And believe it or not, it's been cooking quite a while. It's been cooking overnight. And it's been like a little crock scenario in the oven. So, you know, this chicken enchilada thing, where'd it come from? Well, it goes way back. I won't give you too much history, but they say it goes back to the ancient Mayan days. And that's quite a long time ago. I'm talking a few thousand years ago. So, but it wasn't until the 16th century with the Spanish conquistadors that came from Spain to Mexico for this invasion, and there's a big, you know, historical aspect of it, that this dish was made prominent. And they were absolutely amazed at how these Mexicans, the natives, took these corn tortillas and they made them rolls out of them, and they put proteins in the middle in various scenarios. And they, you know, originally they made these corn tortillas with fish in them way back 1,000, 2,000 years ago, because there was a lot of fish native in Mexico, especially on the coastline, and that was their main source of protein. They weren't real big on poultry and beef and what have you. A lot of that was brought to the Europe by the Europeans in the 15, 1600s, especially cheese. Cheese was not a big component in Mexico until about the 16, 1700s. So that's a little bit about the background of it, but obviously today enchiladas is mainstream, and people of all countries, you know, desire to make Mexican food. And that is one of the great contributions they've made to the American culture. So what we've done is we've taken the liberty to pre-cook some of that chicken. So I'll take this pot out here. I'll put it on that an insulator there, this heat pad. Take the lid off. See what we got going on in here. Oh my goodness, look at that. We got some lovely chicken inside there. Been cooking on 200. Cooking on 200 for upwards of 8 or 10 hours. So you might say to yourself, wow, who's got time for that? Well, you know, maybe you do. You can achieve the same dish by simmering your chicken for an hour or even two on the stovetop. But I really like when this stuff becomes, you know, just so soft that it just tenderizes and falls off. So we're gonna take a little bit of that all the skin off, by the way, not a little bit. Take the skin off. You can just probably pull it to the side. So I've got that chicken in there for, again, 7-8 hours on 200. It's low enough to make you believe the stove is not on, but it's just warm enough to really give it the right temperature. So let me get a spoon here and take one of these chicken legs out. Look at it, literally falls apart. That's the secret. You know, that's where the love is. There's a lot of love in longevity as far as cooking. You know, when you make it fast and you make it with haste, you don't get the right results. Something's either too tough, it's burnt, doesn't have the right seasoning, nothing marinated correctly. And, you know, ultimately, because when you bite into those enchiladas, you want them to be so fork tender that it just shreds. So what we'll do is we'll there's a lot involved with this meal in respects to a lot of your dishes and pots, and it can be a little overwhelming if you do it the authentic style, or you can just buy them, you know, frozen, in the supermarket, but you're not going to get that flavor. So we're going to pull that chicken apart. Look at it, the bone just falls out. Look at that. That's what you're looking for, is the meat like that. Try not to get any of that skin in there. That's not very delightful for someone to get skin or some of those tendons and things like that. I don't think you can achieve this as well with the breast meat. There's something about that thigh meat and the leg that does that. There's not a lot of fat in the breast. I do think that's where a lot of the flavor comes. So you want to get your fork, and you want to sort of shred it, almost like a pulled pork scenario. You can do all this. Now, eventually, I'm going to have to get gritty here, and when this chicken cools and we season it correctly, I'm going to be in the rolling fashion. You just can't do that with gloves. So just remember, wash your hands thoroughly. You know, have consideration for your guests or your family in respects to germs or, just general cleanliness. Okay, that chicken meat is right on target. That's the consistency you're looking for. We'll put that aside for a few moments. Right on that plate, we'll bring over our trusty cutting board. I've got to rinse a few things real quick. I know this is sort of mundane or repetitive, but I just want to encourage you to do that. And that's the cilantro. A lot of sand in that cilantro, so you want to rinse it off. Put some water in there. I'm in a little hurry because of the show, but try to get most of the stems out on the first try. And then you can. Some people have colanders in the civilized world, but I use these man-made colanders. Fingers. All right, one more rinse. Two rinses is good. Key ingredient here, you know. They have enchiladas you make with enchiladas chili roja, which means enchiladas with red tomato sauce, you know, or red chilies. It's really big. There's enchiladas frijoles. I know I'm not saying it like super correct, but you get the idea. That's enchiladas strictly made with, you know, a bean or bean sauce. You know, they make enchiladas that have strictly vegetables in them, and potatoes, you know, sort of like the Mexican version of empanadas, you know, the Puerto Rican dish, which is awesome. So, hey, you can make enchiladas any way you like. You could put, you could have carne enchiladas with red meat in them if you want. You know, Spanish food, I'll tell you. Especially the Mexican stuff, they've got such a variety of dishes, and it really is super healthy, a lot of it, because they got the right balance of the protein versus the carb. And I don't know of too many dishes in the Mexican culture that don't give you lettuce, tomatoes, onions, cilantro, you know, lime, and peppers. Talk about peppers. These people know peppers. I mean, I thought the Italian people liked peppers. But the Spanish and the Mexican, they have such a wide variety of peppers that they use in various dishes that it's almost a science just to study the peppers. And ultimately, when we get done this dish, we're going to top it with some of those peppers to give it an authenticity. Okay, now we've got our cilantro cut. We're going to open our cheese up. Typically, the cheese is, queso fresco in Spanish. You know, it's like a fresh Mexican cheese. It's okay, I like it, and that's super authentic. I think you get more flavor, though, from like some of this American, you know, generic stuff that you can buy. In this case, like a bag of cheese that's mixed, you know, four ways. So while all this is going, let's start our side dishes so we know how to put this all together, because I'm not just going to make the enchiladas. I'm going to incorporate two little authentic side dishes with it to make it a complete authentic meal. First thing, we need this pan over here on at least low to medium heat, and that's for the tortilla process. And we're going to need one of these pots back here for for the beans. Now, unless you can make your own refried beans, you're probably just better off buying them in a can, okay? Refried beans in a can. You can get them vegetarian style. You can get them with a little bit of animal stock or chicken stock in them. In this case, you want to put a little bit of fresh water into the pot. Get those beans, take them out, and you're going to plop the whole scenario right in there. You can't put that straight in the pot because it's going to stick on you, no matter how low you have it. So put a little bit of water in there to lighten up the broth, if you will. I might have put a little bit too much, so I'm going to extract some of that water. Just the right amount to keep it flowing, okay? We'll let that reduce. Bring it down the size. If you're using them non-stick pots, hey, look at my new pot set. And I picked this up somewhere and pretty affordable. Got like 7-8 pieces to it. Non-stick, you know. I'm moving into the professional world now. So I got this bean mixture going right here. I'll put that on low. I made a big mess over here. Let me get my rag. I don't like that right there. That's bad for the camera. All right, wash the hands. Back to the towel. We got the beans going. The second thing is, you know, we're gonna get a rice thing going too. All right, we can put that over there. You get the idea about the chicken. We already know how to cook that chicken. Now we're gonna have a second dish back here. It's a rice dish. Now I know this is an authentic Spanish rice, but it is a nonetheless, it's a side complement dish. A little bit of water. This is all secondary for the main dish. It's kind of like, it's kind of for garnish, you know. It's almost like instant Spanish rice. So we'll get that going in the rear. You can buy that. I got this at Aldi's for like 99 cents. They got some good stuff at Aldi's, you know. So that's kind of going there. Got the pan for the tortillas. This dish right here, what do we want to do with this? We want to make this our chili, our verde sauce, excuse me, our green verde sauce. Not too expensive, like $1.89 for green sauce. Now I want to talk about this a little bit, this green sauce. You know, I mean, if you want to take the time to make this, you can do it. And it really consists of, you know, green tomatoes. Hard to get. You might have them in your neighborhood, or it might be the right season for that, or you're growing them in the backyard in the summertime. Green tomatoes. You're going to need onions, garlic, and like a cubano pepper or some sort of large green pepper. Call it, you know, even a bell pepper will suffice. You're going to saute some of the stuff. You're going to steam those tomatoes until they fall apart. The tomatillas, I believe they're called. Tomatillos, they're called, yeah. And you want to get those, and they peel them off with this kind of like leafy skin on the outside. That's the one you want. You don't really want the green garden tomatoes. You want the tomatillas. Once you get all that done, you're going to put it in a blender. I'm just going through this real fast. Put it in a blender. You're going to liquefy it. You're going to add some seasoning to it. If you're old school and you got like the pizzeria thing going on with the Italians with the tomatoes, you're going to use one of these Presto jiggers from the 50s. This is neat. This is hard to get. This is another thrift store flea market, you know, opportunity I seized about 6 months ago. And you can put the tomatoes in there, the tomatillas, even the peppers, and you're going to grind. So when you grind that, you're going to get just the right consistency in your pot or your plate. And that's kind of how you make, you know, the verde sauce. So we're going to put the verde sauce right now, right in the pot, and warm it up for us. So when we put it in the oven, we're not dealing with cold verde sauce. You want it warm, okay? So the next scenario is going to be, how do we put these together? Well, you're going to need a nice little bake pan. In this case, you know, I'm going to use this little pot right here, okay? What I want to do is, if I can, is put some of this chicken, just for instructional purposes, in a bowl. And I'll tell you why. You got in there in a bowl. And we're going to get some of that chicken broth that we had left over. This pot would help. The one we cooked in the oven earlier, we're gonna get a little bit of that chicken broth and put in there, and just to keep it tender and keep things moving, okay? I'm gonna salt and pepper again. Simple meal, not too hard. You can put a little bit of cilantro if you want to get it going through the mix. Bring it around again, properly seasoned. The chicken's cold enough now almost where I can start working with it. All right, so what we want to do is get big towel there. What we want to do is get these tortillas moving in the right direction. So need a plate to stack the tortillas. Traditionally, in the Mexican culture, they're gonna call for you to put oil in a pan. They're gonna call for you to put oil in a pan for the tortillas. I'm gonna try to do that without the oil, just so we can be a little healthier. If you try to put the chicken in these tortillas without the heating process, you're gonna see what's gonna happen and you're gonna be very upset. It's all gonna crumble on you. So there's a reason why we just lightly warm them up. Okay, so you want some in the bottom for the nonstick process, okay? Back over here to the drawing board, verde sauce. Got tortillas working pretty good. They're getting quasi crunchy. Takes about, depending on how high the heat is. Looks like this rice is almost done. You want to go in a bowl with it. A little on the warm side. Okay. All right, so we got some tortillas that are ready to go on this plate. I'll put three more right behind it while we're talking. This way, keep the show rolling. That's all. It's going to be a little messy, folks, so just bear with me for a second. So now we're going to, again, I just washed my hands. I know this is the dirty part. There's no way around it. There's no way around it. So we're going to get the tortilla, and then you're going to put the chicken in the middle like that. Spread it long ways. If it's too much, it won't close correctly. Okay. And then you're gonna roll it like so. Anytime. You can see why they use the oil on the tortilla, because it sort of crisped it up a little bit. So that's why you have to, if you're gonna cook it without oil, make sure you cook it a little longer. They got to bubble almost. You know, the tortilla has to bubble and be crunchy a little bit. In this case, so we gotta roll it nice, tuck it in there, right in there, little piggies in a blanket of sorts. We got another one here that's, see that little bubbling factor? That's what you want. You want the bubble. You can dip them all the way around. Sort of like paper mache, except you're gonna eat this mache. Okay, shredded chicken. It's the main ingredient, seasoned shredded chicken. Cumin, a little bit of taco seasoning, salt, pepper, okay. See, now they're rolling just right because they're supple. They're not breaking and tearing in part on me or half on me. Yeah, slap them. I guess in the art world they have this stuff called, I don't know, it's called jassu or something. It's in French. It's this stuff that you put on the outside of a painting. Once a painting is done or some sort of etching is done, they slather this. There's jassu on it, I think it's called. I might be pronouncing it wrong. That's what reminds me of it. But that's what you're... You got a Mexican slathering sauce here. So got a couple that are bubbling up. Almost browning here a little bit. That's all right. Nobody's going to be offended if it's a little on the brown. It's very authentic. Got that rustic tortilla look to it. More chicken. After a while, it becomes like a factory production. Then you get good at it, you know? Practice makes perfect, right? Put that in there. Maybe that'll be enough to get to get our finished product in the oven so we can realize what it looks like. Add the final mixture, okay? And the final mixture will be, in this case, you want to make the verde sauce. Actually, a little bit of cilantro. You want the verde sauce on top. Verde sauce on top. Nice and warm. Make sure it's all covered. Cheese. Don't be bashful with the cheese. Right in the oven, no lid necessary. 350, you're gonna be in there for 5 or 10 minutes. It's all you need when you're getting ready to plate up to a degree. Let's move this out of the way so we can see the final product. Okay, folks, we're gonna plate up the chili, the enchiladas, verde style, and we're gonna pull it out of the oven. It's been in there maybe 15 minutes at 300. So all you're looking to do is melt the cheese and keep it warm. We had hot enchilada sauce already in there. Now the final product. See how these turned out. Oh, it looks so good. Awesome. Right on the plate. Two is usually enough for a young person. Three for somebody who really wants to get into it. I'm gonna top it off. A little bit of lettuce, just a little bit. Some tomatoes with green chilies. If you really want to get authentic, you can use something like this, a chipotle pepper. Slice it real fine. Garnish with a chipotle pepper. That'll spice it up for you. Obviously, you could put jalapenos on or something like that. But that is somewhat authentic. And let's see how she worked out. Take that fork there. Nice little knife. Tender. Looking for that chicken inside. There she is. Nice, soft, supple chicken. Mixture, a little bit of everything. Folks, I feel like I'm in Tijuana, Ensenada, wherever that is, Southern California. How they say in the Mexican culture, Ochihuahua, which is like, wow, that's what you want. Chicken enchiladas with verde sauce, topped with green chilies and chipotle pepper. Right here, the Chef Mario's Kitchen. Little side dish of some authentic refried beans. Spanish rice. Make the rice any style you want. I'm so glad you tuned in. I hope you enjoyed this episode. I hope you get busy on this dish. Email me. Let me know how you make out. Or go to NewburgDeli.com. Check out our previous episodes and our show schedules. And just love to see you down at the deli sometime. Great to see you. God bless. Have a great week.
Smart Touch technology changes the way you interact with water. Simply touch anywhere on the faucet body or handle to turn water on or off. A Smart Touch equipped faucet can also tell the difference between a push and a touch. An LED light indicates when Smart Touch is active. Manual operation is always available. Smart Touch also works to conserve water by activating flow only when needed. At the same time, its flexible operation promotes safe food handling. Whatever your age or ability, add a new level of safety and convenience to your kitchen with Smart Touch technology by Brizo.